Happy day, students. Today we are going to discuss about social science topic, democratic politics, chapter 1, power sharing, grade 10. What do you mean by power sharing? Is it possible to share power? Because power is not a physical quantity in your hand that you can cut it into half and give it to others. That would be the first question that will come to your mind. And second question that would come to your mind is, even if it is possible to share power, would it be an intelligent decision to share power? Whatever power I am having, if I give little bit of that power to somebody else, won't that make me weak? So would it be an intelligent decision from my point of view? That would be the second question that will come to your mind. But we have to bear in mind and understand that power sharing, if we do, accumulation of power in any one hand will not take place. That means what? One particular person will never become too powerful. Because if such a situation arises where the entire power is in the hands of one person, what is the guarantee the decision that is taken by person would be a smart decision? What is the guarantee it would benefit the society? So we should always understand that power sharing is an intelligent delegation of power at different levels, and this will help in effective administration of the society. Now, in order to understand the concept of power sharing, in this lesson, we are going to do two case studies, one of Belgium, one of Sri Lanka, right? Now, we will start off with Belgium. Let us understand first the location, size and population of Belgium, okay? Belgium is a small country in Europe, smaller in area than state of Haryana. If you take Haryana in our state, it is in fact smaller than that. It has borders with France, Netherlands, Germany and Luxembourg. It has population of very little, over 1 crore. It is half the population of Haryana. So this is basically the size and location of Belgium. We know that Belgium is a very small country. The population is very less even compared to the state of Haryana. But now the actual story starts. The linguistic diversity in Belgium is something very unique. It is very different than you can expect anywhere. The ethnic composition of this small country, Belgium, is very complex. How complex can it be? It's a small country. So now let me explain. Let me take a marker. Let me explain. Now, out of the total population in Belgium, 59% of people who are living in the Flemish region, that is the yellow region in the map, 59% they live in Flemish region and they speak Dutch language. So these people who are living in the yellow region, they are speaking Dutch language. Okay, the remaining 40% of people live in the Wallonia region. Again, I'm circling the red color region. The remaining 40% of people live in the Wallonia region and they speak French. So for 59 plus 40 is over, we are left with 1%. Okay, so the 1% speak German and they are present in this particular area. Understood now? So again, recapitulating, Flemish region, which is yellow in color, 59% of people speak Dutch. Okay, when it comes to red color, Wallonia, they speak French. 1% German speaking. Now, that means in entire country, Belgium, Dutch, 59% speaking, Dutch speaking community is majority, and 40% French speaking community living in the red region are minority. This is fine. This is with reference to the entire country. Now, let me take another colored marker. Let us come to the capital city. I'm circling in the middle, the capital city, Brussels. Okay, now in Brussels, the situation is totally different. Okay, now again, recapitulating, in the entire country, Dutch is dominating, French is minority. In Brussels, it is reverse. That means what? French is dominating, Dutch is minority. Brazil's presents a very unique situation. The Dutch-speaking people constitute majority in the country, but when it comes to Brazil's, they become a minority. The French-speaking community, which are a minority in the entire country, when they come to Brazil city, they become a majority. Now you see how complex the linguistic diversity in Belgium is. We have learned so far that Belgium is a very small country, but however the ethnic diversity is complex. Now let me tell you a fact. There were a lot of tensions between Dutch speaking and the French speaking community in 1950s and 1960s. Lot of tensions happened. Why the tension happened is because the minority French speaking communities, what I'm circling here on the map, the minority French speaking communities were relatively rich and powerful than compared to the majority Dutch speaking community in the country. So the French speaking community was relatively rich and powerful than the Dutch speaking community. Okay, now the reason why is this French community realized and invested in economic development and education sooner than the Dutch. They realized the importance of economic development, they realized the importance of education, they invested on it and they acquired all these. Dutch speaking community, this realization came little bit late. So that is why the French speaking community was relatively rich, and this was not liked by the Dutch community. They did not like it. Now let us go to story of Sri Lanka, a case study of Sri Lanka. Everybody knows where Sri Lanka is present. Okay, Sri Lanka is an island nation. Okay, just a few kilometers off the southern coast of Tamil Nadu. It has about somewhere around 2 crore population, about the same as Haryana. Okay, now let us see the ethnic diversity in Sri Lanka. Okay, Sri Lanka also has gotten a complex ethnic diversity. Here we see Sinhala speakers were 74% indicated by the yellow region, maximum majority Sinhala speakers. Tamil speakers we had 18% and others were 8%. So within this Tamil speaking also, again we had got a slight division here. Okay, there are native Tamilians who were called as a Sri Lankan Tamilians, which constituted this. I'm talking for the 18%. In this 18% also, we had Sri Lankan Tamils who were the native Tamilians, which is only 13%. So the remaining out of 18, that is remaining out of 18, the rest were forefathers who came from India as plantation workers during the colonial period, and these were called the Indian Tamils. So within this 18% also, you see that 13% are native Tamils. The remaining percentage were called as the Indian Tamils. So this is the diversity in Sri Lanka. Okay, based on the language. Now let us move on to the next slide. Here you see that not only based on the language, okay, even the religion that was followed here, there was diversity. Religious diversity was also present in Sri Lanka. Okay, now let us see what is the diversity. Most of the Sinhala speaking people are Buddhists. Okay, Sinhala is a majority, again please bear in mind. While most of the Tamils are Hindus or Muslims, we are talking about the Indian Tamils, the native Tamils as well as the Indian Tamils. They are Hindus or Muslims. There are about 7% Christians who are both Tamils and Sinhala. That means what? In contrary to Belgium, in Sri Lanka, we have got diversity based on the language that is spoken and based on the religion that is followed also, diversity is present. Now, the next question. Belgium also diversity is present. Sri Lanka also diversity is present. In Belgium, we already know that little bit of conflict was happening between the Dutch and the French. Now, what more could have happened? In Belgium, let us see what more could have happened. In the country Belgium we are taking, not Brussels. Okay. In the Dutch community, which is numerically majority in the entire community, they could have forced their will. They could have forced their will on the French and the German speaking. They could have done that because they were majority. Okay, whatever conflict they already had, this would have pushed the conflict further. They already had conflict, and this Dutch trying to force their will on the French and the German in the country would have intensified the problem. Agreed? Okay, now let us see. Now let us come to Sri Lanka. Sri Lanka, we know the Sinhala community enjoyed bigger advantage. and they can impose their will on the entire country. So these are the possibilities I am talking, what could have happened. Okay, now let us see what exactly happened in the later slides. Now we know what possibilities could have happened. What exactly happened is what we are going to see now. First, we are going to start off with Sri Lanka. In Sri Lanka, they followed a concept called majoritarianism. Okay, now let us go into detail. Sri Lanka emerged as an independent country in 1948. Now, who was by numerically, who was majority here? Sinhala speakers were majority. Therefore, the leaders of Sinhala community sought to secure dominance. They formed the government because simple, they were majority. Okay. Then they passed something called as a majoritarian measures, okay, in order to see that their supremacy is ensured in the country. What were these majoritarian, let me take an highlighter, majoritarian measures were adopted by the Sinhala government. What were these majoritarian measures? Okay, in 1956, an act was passed that declared Sinhala as the official language. Okay, Sinhala is becoming the official language, but bear in mind there are people who speak Tamil also. So, but in spite of that, they have declared Sinhala as the official language, okay, disregarding the Tamils. The government also followed preferential treatment, okay, and they favored Sinhala applicants for various university positions and government jobs. Sinhala applicants for university jobs and government jobs were given first preference. Okay, in addition to this, a new constitution stipulated that state might foster Buddhism, but you must know that the religious diversity is also there in Sri Lanka. Other than Buddhism, there were also people who were following Islam and Christianity. What will happen to them? Sinhala was not spoken by everyone. They were Tamil speakers, and they were people who did not follow Buddhism and who were following other religion. So what will happen to that, to those people? So finally, what will happen? They will start revolting when such measures are adapted. Now we know that they have Sri Lanka, Sinhala government in Sri Lanka has decided to follow majoritarianism. Now, and they started passing various majoritarian measures. All these government measures coming one after the other, gradually it increased a feeling of alienation among the Sri Lankan Tamils. They felt that their sentiments, their language and their religion is not respected at all. So what will happen? They will start revolting. So that the Sri Lankan Tamils, that is, and along with the Indian Tamils, they started launching political parties and started struggling for recognizing Tamil as also an official language. Remember, the Sinhala government passed a law that Sinhala would be the, Sinhalese would be the official language. Now they wanted autonomy also. Wherever, in whichever region in Sri Lanka, the Tamil speaking people were accumulated more, the percentage was more, they wanted it to be a separate alam, a separate state. They started demanding autonomy. They wanted, Tamil also to be recognized as one of the official languages. Definitely, Sinhala government is not going to agree. And in fact, this conflict between the Tamil speaking and the Sinhala speaking led to a civil war which lasted for a very long time. And this civil war led to the complete economic breakdown of Sri Lanka. And many lives were also lost in Sri Lanka because of majoritarianism. We know what happened in Sri Lanka, majoritarianism, the result was not good. Now let us go into Belgium. Did Belgium follow majoritarianism? No, Belgium did not follow majoritarianism. In fact, they followed something called as accommodation. The word accommodation itself means accepting others. It literally explains what happened here. The word accommodate, you are going to accommodate others. So here you see there's some elements of the Belgium model of the governance can be seen here. Okay, Belgium leaders, they took a different path here. They recognized the existence of regional differences and cultures, and between 1917 and 1993, in fact, their constitution was amended 4 times in order to accommodate the different language speaking people. Okay, so they came up with a model which is called as the Belgium model, which is very unique. Okay, that is what we are going to discuss here. Here you see number of Dutch and French speaking ministers shall be equal in the central government. You should know that in the entire country Belgium, Dutch was dominating and French was minority. But in the central government, Dutch and French speaking ministers will be equal. They did not say in the country since Dutch is dominating, Dutch should be more and French should be less. They didn't say that. So entire country, that means in central government, Dutch and French speaking ministers will be equal. Okay, now in the individual states also, many parts of central government have been given to state governments. State governments had a percentage, a degree of autonomy. Now coming to Brussels. Brussels, French is dominating, Dutch is minority. Brussels had a separate government, again in which both the communities had equal representation. Okay, since the Dutch in the country agreed for equal representation in central government, the French also agreed for equal representation in the Brussels government. They did not say no. In addition to this, there is something called as community government that has been established in Belgium. Okay. This community government is elected. Community government is very unique. Let me highlight it so that it gets registered in the mind. Community government, okay. Now this community government elected by people belonging to one language community, Dutch, French and German. That means Dutch will have Dutch community government, French will have French community government, and German speaking will have their own community government. What is the job of this community government? This government has the power regarding cultural, educational, language related issues. So all these issues this community government will be handling. See how complex it is, but it is very, very successful because people continue to live in peace in country. Unlike in Sri Lanka, Sri Lanka majoritarianism led to civil war, but accommodation in Belgium did not lead to any kind of civil war. Though initially they had conflicts, that was clearly solved when lot of amendments, 4 amendments were made in the constitution to come up with the Belgium model. Now this slide summarizes what happened in Belgium and Sri Lanka. Okay, now both are democracies only. In Sri Lanka also it's an elected government only, but majority was Sinhala, so they elected their own people. Both are democracies, but in what way they differed? Power sharing was different in both the countries. Okay, in Belgium what did they follow? They followed accommodation, because why? Leaders have realized that unity of country is possible only if you respect everybody in the country. So accommodation was followed in Belgium. But what was the drawback in system followed by Sri Lanka? They followed majoritarianism. Okay, that means dominance of majority community. Sinhala, by refusing to share power with Tamils, resulted in disunity. Majority government, they wanted dominance, they took dominance, this led to civil war. Clear? So we can arrive at the answer to this question, why power sharing is desirable. Okay, but in order to make it even more simple, there are 2 reasons why power sharing is desirable. One is prudential reason and one is moral reason. What is the difference? How do we understand? In simple words, let me put for you what is not told in slide. Prudential means what you are thinking with your mind. Moral reasons means you are thinking with your heart. Think like that. So prudential, you are thinking with your mind, you will look for logic, statistics, results. Okay, so when you arrange for power sharing in your country, it will avoid conflicts. Majority cannot rule over minority. Good way to ensure political stability. So your mind has taken a decision. Moral reasoning, when you talk about the true spirit of democracy, is power sharing, where everybody has equal opportunity in administration. So that you are thinking with your heart. So moral reason, that is a moral reason. 2 reasons for power sharing: prudential reason and moral reason. Having established now power sharing is ideal, it is the most intelligent method of administration, we have to understand, are there different forms of power sharing? Can power sharing be done in different methods? Of course, it can be done in different methods. It can be categorized under headlines: horizontal power sharing, vertical power sharing, division of power among different social groups, division of power among political parties, pressure groups and movements. About each one, we are going to read in detail in the coming slides. Now this is the first method of power sharing, which I have told in the previous slide. This is the horizontal power sharing. You see here, horizontal, literally I am drawing a line, horizontal power sharing. We have got three organs in the government. One is the legislative, another is the executive, and another is the judiciary. Now, legislative, parliament. Okay, parliament. We have both Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, where decisions are taken, decisions are decided. Whatever decisions are taken in the legislative will be executed by the executive, which is the ruling government, the government in power. They will execute it. So now we know legislative takes the decisions and executive implements it. So where does judiciary come into picture? Whatever decisions are taken by the legislative and the method of implementing by the executive, if there is any flaw or if there are any doubts, the judiciary will come into picture. Judiciary can always check whatever is done by the other two organs if it is wrong. What do I mean by wrong? If it is against the constitution, this judiciary can question the other two organs and ask them to correct their decision. And how are these two organs checking each other, that is legislative and executive, how are they checking each other? Whatever decision is taken by the legislative, is it implemented accordingly? So horizontal power sharing, and here each organ is checking the other organ. Each organ has autonomy, but at the same time it is under the scrutiny by the other organ. Hence we can call this kind of power sharing as horizontal power sharing, or we can also call it as system of checks and balances. They are going to check each other and they are going to balance each other. So horizontal power sharing or checks and balances, three organs: legislative, executive, and judiciary. Moving on to the next one, vertical distribution of power. Okay, vertical distribution, if you take India, take into mind India because you can understand it even more clearly. We have got a central government, which we call as a union government, at the center. Okay, powers are given to central government based on the union list. Then below that we have got the state government. State government also has got autonomy. It also has certain subjects that are mentioned in the state list, where the state government can take decisions according to their will. However, they are answerable to the union government if they ask for explanation. Okay, so initially these two tiers were present, TIER, you can also call tiers. Two tiers were present. Federal system, it was called as a two-tier government. Later on we have decided that we need another tier, another level of government, which is called the municipality and panchayat, the local governance, so that this self-governing which we have in democracy can become even more effective, because there are certain problems which need not come to the state or center. In the village level only people can solve it. So in order to make it possible, in order to maximize the participation of people at village level also, the third tier of government, which is called the municipality and panchayats, have been established. Therefore, this is a vertical sharing of power. So see how I'm drawing it. This is a vertical sharing of power. Previously it was horizontal. Now this slide is about vertical sharing of power. Now we have power sharing among different social groups. Okay, already we have read about community government in Belgium, how effective it was. Not only in Belgium, we also in India have power sharing among different social groups. You know that seats are reserved for backward communities in elections, certain reserved constituencies, which you have read previously in standard 9. It is another method of power sharing. For women also we are reserving seats, that is also a method of power sharing. For minority communities also seats are reserved, that is also power sharing. So power sharing among different social groups. Next we move on to power sharing among political parties, pressure groups, and movements. Now let us see power sharing among political parties. You know about coalition government. In election, if any one party does not get majority seats, what do? They join hands with another political party. One more or two more parties or three parties can join hands to form a government. That is nothing but power sharing. Coalition government is an example of power sharing only. Okay, pressure groups also. Here we see people going on strikes and demonstrations. So these are pressure groups that bring about pressure on the government to change their administration technique. So power sharing only, where pressure groups are showing their involvement in administration. So various movements, demonstrations, peaceful strikes which we carry on, that also is a sort of power sharing. In democracy, we find that interest groups such as rich business people, traders, industrialists and farmers, they tend to express their opinion in a governance. Okay, there is nothing wrong in taking opinion, because it is not that in last year you have read political executives and permanent executives. Political executives need not be perfect in all the subjects. Sometimes they need advice from other groups also. So sometimes such interest groups also advise the government, advise only, okay, they cannot influence completely. They give advice to the government regarding various decisions that can take place in bringing an effective administration. So various industrialists, businessmen, traders also play their role in administration, in power sharing. So with this, we come to the end of the chapter. Kindly go through the content that is given in the chapter. Thank you.